In this time and the next time, I will explain to you the issues related to trade in the 17th century. First, I will choose the topic of textile trade. And the first chapter, I will tell you the basic trade relation between Taiwan and Japan. And in the following chapters, our subject will change to that of two famous kinds of Southeast Asian textiles, which show us the relationship among East, Southeast, and South Asia. In the 17th century, when Taiwan was entering into a new historical period, a basic trade structure connected several areas of Asia, such as shown in this map. Although Chinese silk was very famous in the world, it was Indian cotton which had a more important role in the trade connection relating to the birth of textile culture in Southeast Asia. Deerskin in Taiwan was deeply linked with arms products in Japan. In the first chapter, I will talk about two places in Taiwan, which are Anping in Tainan and Tanzhou in Xinbei City. Among the animals in Taiwan, deer or Formosan deer in their scientific name were the most important one during the 17th to 18th century. As like in the 18th century's paintings, deer hunting became the most valuable activity for the aboriginal peoples in Taiwan because their skin was exported as the only Taiwanese product. Deer skin has special characteristics such as strength and softness, which are almost never found in other animal skins. And many deer lived in a wide area of field in Taiwan at that time. Therefore, deer skin was typified as a Taiwanese product. We have good historical evidence of Taiwanese deer skin as seen in the right pictures. This is a painting of Anping Port, which is written on the deer skin. And we can find Zeelandia Fort and the Provincial Fort in the circle of this painting. Zeelandia Fort in Anping was built by the Dutch in 1623, and for a long time after, it continued to be used as the government place of Taiwan. At the present time, there still remains several parts of Dutch-made brick walls, such as in the left picture. And the provincial fort was also constructed by the Dutch. Now in here, we can see the modern statue of imagination for the surrender of the Dutch governor to Chen Zhenfeng, such as depicted in the right picture. There also remains another similar deer skin painting of the scenery of Anping Port, seen in the left picture. This port area is written in the red circle of the Dutch map of Taiwan from 1640. As is well known, Taiwan, the original name of this port, became the name of this entire island later. These two pictures show you typical Japanese armor after the 16th century. Ordinary Japanese armor was manufactured with a combination of iron plate and animal skin, which started after the 5th century. Among the several kinds of animal skin, deer skin was chosen as the best one, especially during the 16th century. In the period of Civil War, demand for deer skin rapidly increased. not only Ama itself, but also Jimbaori, the special coat over Ama for generals was manufactured by deer skin, such as seen in the left picture. This technique for deer skin continued in the manufacturing of small leather works after the 17th century, such as in the right picture. At around the 16th century, Japan was involved with world trade through its production of silver. Besides the silver in Latin America, Japanese silver, mainly produced in the Iwami mine, seen in the left picture, became one of the major currencies of the world. For getting silver ingots, such as in the right picture, many foreign goods, including Taiwanese deer skin, were brought into Japan. At that time, Taiwanese Aboriginal people had faced a drastic changing of their economic activity. Foreign traders, at first mainly Fujianese and Japanese, and then next the Dutch, asked them for deer skin to export to Japan. In return, they sold many Chinese ceramics as barter goods, but at the same time, Indian cotton acted as another good commodity in the world. Probably by being involved with such a connection, the Shiraya tribes, who had stayed close to Anping, have a cotton textile culture as seen in these pictures. This, however, was an indirect relation with Indian cotton. Now, we will enter into the second chapter, the first part of the textile trade relation in the eastern half of Asia. This chapter will be focused on the Indian origin wax-resistant cotton dyeing technique, which is called batik. This type of cotton cloth was exported from Gujarat and Coromandel Coast in India to Southeast Asia, especially to Java in Indonesia. And the massive stream of this trade had reached to the other islands in Indonesia, such as Sulawesi or to Nagasaki in Japan. In Japan, there is a famous old cotton cloth samples collection from after the 17th century. Although all of the cloth samples are very small in size, almost all of them still show us vivid and beautiful primary colors, such as can be seen in these pictures. Including the previous two pictures, these samples are Indian cotton cloths, which were dyed by the wax-resistant technique called batik. Judging by this cloth samples collection, we can easily estimate how large quantity of Indian cotton batik were imported to Japan. In fact, not only small samples, but also complete large clothes dyed by such a technique had been remaining until the present time in Japan, such as seen in these pictures. These dyeing motifs are totally different with Japanese traditions from before the 16th century. These pictures are the other example of old Indian cotton collections in Japan. In these pictures, these kinds of motifs on cotton clothes were probably seen as an exotic image for Japanese at that time, which was the limited trade policy period. But some of them, especially the stripe motif, was copied by the Japanese cotton industry And raitas became the most popular motif in Japan. Clothing, similar to the old Indian wax resist dyeing cotton, are kept in Indonesia also, such as these two clothes found in Java Island. While the total motif in the left picture became the typical motif of the Japanese batik, the clothes of the right picture was made from a patchwork of trial samples of different motifs. Not only Java, but also the other islands, the old batiks of India are collected. Especially in Sulawesi Island, we can find several good examples from different areas of India. While the left picture shows a cloth of the Coromandel produced batik, the right picture is a Gujarat product batik. Here, I will show you the process of batik manufacturing in these two pictures. As the first step, the drawing of motifs by hot liquid wax on white cotton cloth is done, as seen in the left pictures. In the next step, the cloth was dipped for dyeing, and the wax part was not dyed. For required color numbers, this process was done repeatedly each time. These two pictures show a traditional style of Japanese batik clothes. Usually, geometric motifs were chosen to suit with their favorites. But vivid color, like in the original Indian batiks, were almost never used. These two pictures are of another old traditional motif of Japanese batiks. Basically, in Java, the only choice of color is of brown or blue, and usually it is dyed by a single or double color process. At least before the 18th century, the cotton batik became the common cloth or uniform in the Japanese court, such as seen in the drawing in the left picture. And this batik culture was used by Japanese noblemen as their status symbol during the Dutch colonial period, as small part was influenced by European style, such as in the picture in the late half of the 19th century on the right. Now, we will change to another kind of cotton culture in the east half of Asia. It is the tie-dye technique for cotton yarn, which is called ikat. This technique was also created in India, especially in Gujarat, and it later spread to the island in East Indonesia, such as Sumba. Similar technique of cloth were found in Cambodia or Okinawa and Japan. The ikat is known as kasuri in Japanese. The Japanese traditional ikat mainly dyed with blue color were found in several areas, and the colors are still sold in traditional clothing shops, such as in these pictures. The Okinawa Islands are located at the southwest part of Japan, or close to Taiwan. Before the late half of the 19th century, they held their own kingdom, and during the 15th to 16th centuries, they acted a good trader between East Asia and Southeast Asia. In this Okinawa, we can find another ikat cloth culture such as seen in these pictures. The ikat technique had been started in India, And the old Indian ikat clothes are also found in Indonesia, such as in these pictures. These old Indian ikats have different appearances with Japanese or Okinawan ikats, both which are colored and with motifs, but they were manufactured in the same basic techniques. Now, I will explain the manufacturing process of the ikat. First, it should be started with tie-dye hoo yarn, which is dyed in each brand color. In Sumba, tie-dye is only done for warp yarn, such as in the left pictures. And at the next step, tie-dyed yarn is set on loom and wave with an tie-dyed yarn, such as in the right picture. Sumba is a relatively small island and does not have a large population. Our knowledge for their culture, especially their receiving condition of Indian textile culture, is limited. But at the beginning of the 20th century, when Dutch rule started, their very beautiful ikat was introduced to the other areas. These two pictures show the early ikat of Sumba. A large part of the island in East Indonesia have their own ikat manufacturing tradition. People in these areas formed a large number of small kingdoms, and their society was generally divided into several social classes. People in this area frequently use ikat clothes in each ceremony with a certain rude motif or color. And the manufacturing work also shows their role in the society. In the continent area of Southeast Asia, we can find several similar ikat manufacturing places. Among them, the Cambodian ikat is most famous because they have two traditions of motifs. This included both representational motifs, such as in the left picture, and the geometric motifs, such as the right picture. And now the coat ikat or high quality clothes are weaved with silk yarn. As like as my explanation in this in the topic of today, it is clear that in the textile culture in the east half of Asia, Taiwan is more deeply connected with East Asia. But that time, East Asia itself was already tied with Southeast Asia and South Asia.